Happy Monday. We have made it. Happy solstice. Here we are. Happy pride. Happiness. Happiness and gratitude. Thank you all for joining me. Welcome to the Queer State. Tonight's screening is made possible by the state, I am trying to not use my phone for notes and all of this kind of stuff, and I am too nervous to not do that. So here it is. All right, what did I write? I wrote something that I thought was pretty nice. All right, so here we go. Tonight's screening is funded by the City of Houston through the Houston Arts Alliance, and we would like to thank them. Speaking of we, I would like to thank my Stingerian sisters, Kay Adshead and Margot Stutz-Toombs, for all of their effort and their contributions this evening. Being in this coven of creativity is an honor, and it is a privilege. Speaking of creativity, I want to say thank you to all of the queer staters who contributed work this evening. Your fearless work, your imaginative work, your experimental work, all of your work. Thank you for your service. It is my pleasure, my honor, and I am so excited to be able to share these works with everyone tonight. And really, I think that that's it. I want to get out of the way. I want to show these films, and I just want to tell everyone thank you so much. I want to tell you that I love you. I love you. I love you. I think you all know that. And have a great time. Enjoy, and maybe I'll see you after the show.
What are you? Christo's, Houston, Texas. Table number one, on the mezzanine floor with the giant ferns, the fan palms, and the 17th century Mexican urns. I am sat opposite Soraya. She sips pear martini. Her fingernails are painted gold. So is her soft, wet mouth. Her father is chatting away downstairs in a corner alcove with a gaggle of guffawing suits, leaving his daughter in my care. It's our sixth date. He looks up, winks and waves. I lean into Soraya. She smells of Cheerios and ice-cold milk. She smiles.
You've got to tell her. Now, quick! It's your last chance.
A strange, sparkly, exotically coutured woman with red hair is peering through the huge fan palms.
Now, this minute.
I look around for a server to complain to because you don't expect to bump into this kind of person at Christo's. But when I turn back, she's nowhere to be seen. Soraya squeals. It is so loud the whole restaurant is suddenly silent and watchful, and she proclaims,
Oh, Josh, I love you so much, and I've always wanted a gay bestie.
Her father's eyes narrow like lasers cutting through the lush, moist jungle. The Heights, 19th Street. I'm sitting leaning against a fiberboard partition, alone. Surrounded by glowing rock salt lamps, rock salt bunnies, squirrels, an eagle on a rock, a fish cresting a wave. Out the back I can hear Maximilian chipping away.
There used to be space for me to sit at a little desk and chair, but there are just too many rock salt lamps now.
Oh dear, that looks nasty.
Before glancing up, I recognised the voice.
What's the matter with your hands?
It's the strange sparkly lady. They're red, blistered and sore. I think I must have an allergy to the rock salt.
I'd get that sorted out before your insurance expires, dear.
Right.
How much rent does he owe you now?
Oh, look, it's not like that. She looks concerned.
He's off to Copenhagen next year. Back to Kurt.
I freeze.
Oh, don't worry. He'll be leaving you all the rock salt lamps.
The Empire Cafe Westheimer. Don't ask me when. After Ike. A pavement cafe popular with writers and artists. I am reading Thomas Paine's The Rights of Man. The sun is in my eyes, and as I look up, I see sat opposite the strange red-haired lady. She blinks. I am dazzled by her shimmering gold eyeshadow.
I enjoyed that.
I look confused.
The coffee. Fresh roasted, fragrant and full-bodied.
Yes. Well, I don't make the coffee. I just clean the table afterwards.
How's your book?
Oh, it's excellent, actually.
Independence is my happiness, and I view things as they are, without regard to place or person. My country is the world, and my religion is to do good.
You've read it? A pair of sharp beaks squawking grackles swoop and squabble over my butter biscuit. When I look back, she's gone. Port Aransas, Texas, in a small fishing boat out at sea, midnight. Don't ask me when. Before Harvey.
No customers, dear.
Now you're expecting me to tell you she's sat there in the wet, slimy, fish-stinky boat, aren't you? No, no customers tonight. But that would be crazy. No, she's risen up out of the sparkling black water, still, tall and graceful, silhouetted against the moon. I've given up fishing.
Why? You loved it.
No, I loved being in the boat. I loved being on the water.
How will you...
I'm growing most of my own food now.
Really? I am impressed.
At first, when I hooked a fish and felt the hard tug on the line, it was... Well, it was thrilling. I mean, a big fish puts up a real struggle, you know. Once I hooked an old catfish that was so huge it pulled me into the water and we faced each other, eye to eye, man and fish struggling, the fish thrashing in the bubbling water, my bare hands around his fierce fish jaws. He was bleeding from the hook. I mean, we were swimming in blood. And I thought, if I don't get back into the boat, the sharks will get us. So after a minute, I let him go. He swam away, looking back once with an injured look of gratitude. I climbed back into the boat just in time. A yard away, I saw a dorsal fin clearing the foam, circling. And I thought, I don't want to kill fish anymore.
What will you do if you don't fish?
Well, I've got about 300 rock salt lamps, and they love them round here.
But your poor hands!
Soraya and her bloke help out in the summer. I mean, her kids love it around here. And she's great at displays and marketing and stuff. We might open a little bar or something, you know, live music. I always fancied working up a little act, Lippy, big wig, sparkly frock, 8-inch heels. Now you're talking. I can sing a bit, tell a few jokes.
Really?
But do you know something? If it doesn't work out, it won't matter. The salt water seems to heal just about everything.
soy esa que tú te imaginas, una señorita tranquila y sencilla que un día abandonas y siempre perdona a esa niña. Sí, no, esa no soy yo.
I can't fight it any longer. I must give in to the drama. I'll be right back.
Well, that's why we rented this fabulous beach house, darling. You run along now and have fun. If, in fact, that is what you are sure you want to wear, dear. Why don't you grab one of my designer originals on your way out?
Kim, where are you going?
Co-parent is going for today's existential crisis stroll on the beach, but don't worry, it won't take long.
Sure, that's right. I'll be right back. Or will I?
Be careful. Don't forget the gown.
Bye, bye.
You got it.
This couldn't be, but it was.
Trying to look in the future, I just naturally am thinking about the years to come. She's a perfect wife and the perfect mother. I felt like I had no feeling. I sort of sometimes felt I was just a body doing everyday things, but there was no feeling in me. I couldn't feel anything. I couldn't sort of feel love. I'd led a completely different life from them. My worry when I was young wasn't my manners. Well, nobody's perfect, I mean. Look on the brighter side of things. I mean, there are some things that I do well. I'm a good cook, you know, trying to learn how to do things properly and do things the way they should be done.
Well, I'm back.
Hey, how are you feeling?
I'm all right.
Don't feel ready.
Well, I'm walking up the aisle.
I was drunk already. And I'm walking up the aisle just accidentally. Call my ex, I pocket dialed her as I'm walking. With a gay host, mum flirts, trying to flick the sick off a flannel shirt. Kept the label on it because I don't have to commit.
And that's the only time I'm able to place a label on a miss.
But you can't return a stained shirt. You can't return all of the pain and all of the words. Don't think I'm going to be able to stay up on my feet. Used to can't be stood up, but I'll be sat down on the seat.
Can't see where I'm going as I'm walking up the aisle, because tears keep flowing as I'm walking up the aisle. Mother's hugging all the photos as I'm walking up the aisle. Lots of people here I don't know and I'm walking up the aisle.
Lots of people here I don't know and I'm walking up the aisle. Who the hell are you?
Oh crap, I remember you. We
really nearly hooked up. But don't worry, he was gay too, so he couldn't get it up. Never wanted him up my aisle. It's not something I've ever wanted to try.
No longer in denial, no longer give a toss. COVID-19 got me to OCD to be turning knobs. No longer in denial, no longer give a toss. COVID-19 got me to OCD to be turning knobs. Not a total dyke stereotype, but our first date was down the aisles in home base. Not a total dyke stereotype, but a few weeks later when we're moving in our own place, we were living together within the first few months. Don't group us all together, we've only U-hauled once. Admit it took a minute, took a few seconds, said it for me to fall. What if my heart's not really in it, and these feels ain't really real at all?
Are we just your average typical lesbians? Or was this all just meant to end up in another? Let's be friends. Are we just your average typical lesbians?
Friends. I thought I'm just gonna go slide in the DM. So why am I not walking up the aisle wearing the DMs? Cause I used to be playing the field. Like I was Rapino. Who'd have thought one day you'd be seeing me on one knee? Though the only ring I thought I'd be wearing would be a fingering. Maybe I pushed for this wedding, cause my family did my head in. You're straight, you're not gay. It's all they'd say, you're straight, you're not gay. It's all just a face. You know you're not a dyke or a leather. Just I've not found the right fella.
But if a straight woman can't. But if a straight woman can't. How on earth am I meant to?
How the hell am I meant to?
My heart's stopping. Blood pressure's dropping. You're gonna have to carry me. Don't think that you can marry me, cause I'll have to be carried up that aisle in a coffin.
Coffin.
que diablos fue? Astronautas. Santa madre, tetas.
Yo he venido para usted, Tentacle.
¡Oh, mi señor! ¡Las tetas están armados! ¡Debo advertir al presidente!
¡Alto! ¡Tentacle! ¿Por qué siempre corren de mi consola sola? Qué bueno es que no le muestro el progenitor.
Congrats to you boys in engineering. This new rocket is a much smoother ride than those jerky old rockets we're used to.
Ha ha, it is, Tom. But it isn't the guys you should be thanking. It's actually a design developed by one of our new interns in engineering, a lovely girl called Georgia.
A girl? Really? Well, well, well. Tell her I said thanks. I've never had a nicer ride in my life.
Haha, yeah, we in control nicknamed it the Lady Shaver, because it's strong enough for a man, but made by a lady.
Well, okay. All right, NASA, systems are normal, and I should be reaching my destination and, wait a minute. What is that?
Hey, quiet down, boys. Tom, what's happening? Talk to me.
I don't know, NASA. I thought I saw something materialize on the screen, but I can't see anything now. I'm as blind as a bat.
Tom, keep calm. Are your readouts telling you anything?
Everything's still reading as normal, but...
But what, Tom? Talk to me. What's going on?
I don't know. But I feel like...
Tom, your circuit's dead. There's something wrong. Can you hear me? Major Tom, can you hear me? Major Tom, come in, Tom!
My hands.
Actually, I'm going to begin. It's happening. Okay. Yes, you can the program. So some of y'all have already met FAWN, my friend FAWN, and he's not doing super well these days. The last time those of y'all that met him saw him, he was teaching and learning a lot through that process, and he has not been teaching or learning very much lately. But he did send me some clips of what he's up to. He told me that I could share them with y'all. And I will probably throughout this process be sending him some vocal encouragement as I share the clips that he sent with me, to me. So here we go. Let's just get situated. All right, so can everyone see my box of chaos? The representative from the collective, please unmute their mic and confirm with me that my box of chaos is in the frame.
We can see the box of chaos.
Thank you. You're sitting on my heart right now, and that is where you will remain. Okay, so let's just begin. Something in the way you love me won't let me be. When you hold me in your arms, you love me till I just can't see. And then you let me down when you're not around. Honey, you just can't be found. Stop driving me away. I just wanna say, stay. There's something that I've got to say. Just try to understand. I'm doing all I can. That you got the best of me. Borderline. Feels like I'm gonna lose my mind. You just keep on pushing my way. Over the borderline. It feels like I'm gonna lose my mind. You just keep on pushing my love over the borderline. Yeah. Oh. Yeah. You got FAWN, and you got OIMS. Oh, wow. Oh my God, what are you serving us? I'm serving a
It's okay, fine. Is somebody sent this? Oh, yes. Balancing, being resourceful. My herb is holding the herb. Wow. Yeah, you got it. You are hanging on there. Just hanging on tight. Wow. Very good. We'll just take a bow. Okay.
The way that social mobility is calculated has a lot to do with whether or not your otherness is visible. If you decide to make that visible, you're pretty much calling an end to your social mobility.
When a man identifies as gay, there's like, but you don't talk flamboyant, you can't be gay. Like, just all the stuff that we see on TV, I don't want to say we're desensitized to trueness or to otherness, like we all have to be this way, but in a way we do.
I think as an individual, I might have been, you know, much more androgynous or much more, you know, expressive of my sexuality if I didn't have to grow up in a repressed environment.
Some people say you have like yourself, your presenting self, and then your inner self, and maybe it's that sense of otherness is your inner self.
Okay, almost like a higher self.
Yeah.
So otherness is anybody who has to fit in outside of the picture ideal of what society should be. I think otherness does go a little further, but definitely feeling like you're not a part of the group is huge.
I feel like in the stage we're currently in, we're the most progressive that we have, and we're the most accepting that we have ever been.
I think that people like to take labels and then assign a personality to them.
But with this acceptance, I personally have been finding that there are now more and more boxes that people categorize others in.
But the idea of like LGBT people and success, it has a lot to do with what the majority already has in mind for what they should be.
And even with this inclusion, even with this acceptance, it's like, but you're still confined to these boxes that we've now created. We're progressive, so there's a lot of boxes, but we're still gonna figure out which ones you tick.
There's ideals of what somebody who's like heterosexual or white has about what success should be, and they have ideas of how LGBT people should be, or it offends them if somebody decides to do something unpredictable. The only thing we get in this world is the ability to express ourselves, and the only thing you can ask of somebody is for them to express themselves truly, especially, say, for instance, trans individuals who go through a lot of hardship so that they can realize their, you know, individuality.
Keep being you. And if you're confused on what exactly you means, know that that's okay. And maybe that confusion is actually something beautiful and lovely that you haven't quite put a name on quite yet. Tell your parents you love them, even maybe if you feel like they don't love you. This is your own life, so focus on it.
are sitting in the pub gardens of the King's Head, Roehampton, in London, in the United Kingdom, in May, in a near blizzard. And we are completely alone. We don't know where the waitress has gone, but we think it might be somewhere warm and dry. Roisin is wearing an orange ski suit with lilac faux fur around the hood and round the cuff, which she bought in a charity shop in West Hampstead in 1979 for £4. And I know this because I was with her when she bought him. In front of us, we have two strong and steaming Americanos and two double brandy shots. And it's hailstoning. And when the little spheres of ice break through the surface of the hot liquid, they explode. We are shivering. And we are talking about otherness. What it is to feel other. What is otherness? Now, I know that question might phase other of my friends, but not Roisin. Because I am an expert in this field, as you will know, comrade. And she is, I mean, she really is. Roisin is an expert in otherness. She's 72 years old. She lost her virginity at 60 to a man, Robert, very nice chap, cycling enthusiast, rambler, married him, divorced 9 years later, and 3 days before her 70th birthday, came out as a gay woman. Oh, I love that, you know. I love that, the gay woman, the gay, you know, there's something kind of 19th century about it, you know, a lady on a white horse with a hat with a plume, and, you know, like Margaret Lockwood. And lesbian, and I have no problem with the lesbian because it's classical, it's got gravitas. And, you know, I don't even mind that, you know, homosexual, you know, she's homosexual. Because I think it's a little bit sort of, you know, dirty and secretive. But what I do not like is the Q word, you know? Queer, no. Queer, no. I mean, all the London kids are saying, oh, Roisin, come on. You know, we're taking it back. You know, reclaim it, own it. Own it, no, you own it. Because I find it totally offensive. When she was born in 1949 in the top room of a tidy cottage in a small town outside Dublin, the doctor, Dr. Kelly, who was a family friend, thought she was a boy, and she was brought up for the first 7 years of her life as a male child. With the undescended testicle, but you can imagine what that was like, you know, squeezing into me Sister Colleen's pinafore frock round the back of the bicycle sheds. Connor? Does your mammy know that you've come to school in a frock? Yes, Miss Lynch. I can still taste the blood from where I bit Paddy the barber's hand as he tried to trim my shoulder length curls. I mean, for show and tell, I took him my Grammy's 100-year-old foundation garment. When she was 7, Dr. Kelly, the same Dr. Kelly, asked Connor Ray's mother to bring him into the surgery, which she did, and they jumped him up on the table and they pulled down his pants. And I didn't mind it, you know, not at all, because it's sort of like a distraction technique, you know, yeah. Like they gave me a little Cupid doll in a box and a big bag of jelly babies. And it was there and then that Dr. Kelly finally admitted. And he said these cases, though rare, were not totally unheard of, and that Connor Ray was in fact a lovely little girl. Well, that evening I was sat outside the kitchen, you know, listening to me mammy whisper to me Auntie May, I am a wife and a mother of 4 boys and 3 girls. I mean, I that there was something funny going on down there. I mean, I could see an undetected tentacle when it wasn't there. Roisin's father, Dan the Draper, and the church organist, had no interest whatsoever in his children's genitalia, which was a blessing. So you might think that this was a happy ending for the magnificent 6-foot, green-eyed, blue-haired Roisin. And indeed it might have been, was it not for the fact that 5 days before my 15th birthday, that pesky testicle had not started its slow, very slow descent.
The curve, the poetry of an imperfect line stretched out and drenched in feeling. Soft-eyed with a loose jaw, I'm connected to pleasure, finding ecstasy in the movement of my body, a vehicle for a bliss still deemed rebellious in the eyes of the world. My skeletal frame, long and petite, still a heavily policed carcass that dares to softly reach beyond the bounds of marginalization. I create freedom on my own terms, so I dance, and I cry, and I feel, and I love, And I love, and I'll love, and I'll love again. I embrace my own definition of empowerment by being soft on purpose.
So, I'm telling you in silence, on an empty stage, somewhere in this world. You'll see a slow spotlight, and if you watch long enough, carefully enough, inside the spotlight, a tiny figure will appear, dazzling, in a spectacular, glittery dress and shoes. This is the performer. You will hear an applause. Perhaps he smiles and bows. Anyway, the picture transitions. Yes, that's a good a word as any. It is a beautiful word. The performer is walking home now, after the show. Let's just call him he, shall we? Carries a short, glittery dress on a hanger. He is in full stage makeup, eyelashes and glossy red lips and earrings, but no wig. He wears a simple, short shift. And in 8-inch heels, he struts along a dark, tree-lined road. On either side of him, handsome houses with flower-filled front yards, a typical affluent Houston suburb. You know what I'm talking about. In his head, he hears applause. She smiles, sighs even. He starts to hum. Perhaps he breaks into a single playful skip, for tonight, he is happy, but... As the long street gets darker, there are whispers. Whispers from the houses, from the night. And down the tunnel, his own dark whispering past. Are you that color all over? Can I see? Why you walking like that, boy? Yeah, he walks like a duck. Quack, quack. Take your shirt off, now. Why? Is that your real voice? Yes. He talks like a girl and walks like a duck. Quack, quack. He starts to walk faster up the long, straight, dark road. He's walking faster now, see? Where's he come from? Where's he going? He's carrying something sparkly, something expensive. Call the cops. He stops. He's sweating. He stands very still, trying to breathe from somewhere and nowhere. A stronger voice. A voice not from inside his head. A shadow voice. From here, in the world. Fag. He looks around anxiously from where the voice comes from. Dirty fag. Fruit. I've been watching you. Why? You didn't see me, did you? Because I'm invisible, ain't I? Aren't we? Ordinary folks like us, huh? The performer's breath comes short and fast. You think you look like a woman? No. Only woman you look like ain't good enough to spit on. Hear me? I hear you, all right. Your voice is familiar to me. Any woman you look like, only good for one thing. One thing. Yeah. The man moves out from the shadows. He is very tall. And the performer is looking around and then starts to run down the street, kicking off shoes, trying to escape from the shadow man all the time. You know, holding on to the glitter frock, which sparks flames in the moonlight. And we are close now. Close in now, looking into his eyes. And there are voices. Voices from the great black sky, perhaps not from inside his head, not at all, but further down the tunnel of our shared and terrible past. And we hear old voices from the slave ships, yells from the slave masters on the cotton fields, and we hear the crack of a whip and the scream of the pain of the past. We hear all this, all this. He falls to the ground in the shadows of the trees, panting, exhausted, and peers down the long straight road, expecting to see the shadow man behind him, bearing down over him. But the road is completely empty and silent. He looks up to the moon. He cannot stand. His own legs will not carry him, and suddenly, down the road, a spotlight. He turns. Slowly, in the center of the spotlight, there appears a tiny dancing figure. And the dance, starting light and lyrical, becomes strong, and the arms great like black wings in the moonlight, the neck stretched and sinewy. Slowly, the spotlight shrinks and fades, and the dancing figure turns and speaks. Excuse me? What you doing sitting there in the dust there, friend? You gotta wear that beautiful gown tomorrow. And sparkly bits don't like being scrunched up, I reckon. So stand up so I can see you. He stands up, slowly, very, very slowly, as if for the first time. I love your show. You do? Loved watching you at your toilette table with your powders and your shiny paint pot brushes. You got everything, honey. I rouged my cheeks with red currant juice from the hedgerows when I was a boy. Your costuming was sweet. Nothing feels so civilized, does it, as silk against the skin and satin, real satin. The weave originating in the ancient Chinese city of Jinshao and was called Zaytan in medieval Arabic, hence the name satin today. Oh, I bet you didn't know that, did you, young fella? Satin now, it just catches the light, like fireflies, I'd say. And your singing was fine, and the dancing, well, sublime, and you had dignity, you know? That was the most important thing for me to see, real dignity and refinement. I had dignity? Sure did. But you could have had just a mite more fun. You see, being a queen don't have to be mean, if you're understanding me. The clouds shift across the moon, almost in the shape of a black swan. She looks back and sees William Dorsey Swan dancing in the street, a cakewalk playful that morphs into a timeless, defined, voguing, posing, coming toward the performer. And then the performer himself, herself, is standing now in the place of Swan, makeup perfect, bewigged, wearing the beautiful short glittering dress, and of course, it is me. Oh, you knew that, didn't you? And I am dancing my best dance in the middle of the straight, dark, empty street. And my spotlight is the moon. So that night, that long, dark night under a cool, impartial, listening moon, that night I was shown where I had once been. I was shown my past, the familiar old sneers were stinging slaps that tried to take me down or take me back. They failed. That night, almost at the end, crouching in the dust with fear, a knot in my stomach, sour green bile in my throat, or worse, a noose around my neck, strangling my breath. That night, all my fear left my body. It floated up to the endless black sky where it popped like a balloon. And at that same moment, the crouching dust, instead of choking, glittered in the sidewalk and outshone the stars. It lit up the road ahead. It lit up the road ahead. So, I ask you to go back now to the beginning, to that faraway humming stage somewhere in the world, and you'll see me safe, so safe inside the shimmering spotlight, in my soft, glittering silk and satin to transform, to realize, to release, to relate, to reinvent, to resurrect, to resurrect. What now? Well, the film freezes in on me in my final costume, of course. And geez, I'm looking good. Yes, on stage, taking a bow to a huge applause. And while you get up, stretch out and reach for your phone, will you read them for me? Because we can't allow our best folks to get lost now, can we? Read them. Dedicated with love to the memory of William Dorsey Swan, the child of slaves mocked, persecuted, and imprisoned, who became the first, the very first, Black activist queen.
You're the monster dressed in white. You're the living suicide. You're the loser in your eyes. You're forgiven, but you're right. Gotta relight the fire inside the cannon of ice. Before your freedom departs, gotta reach up and higher, for I admire the strength you see in the dark. You're the mountain I can't climb. Got a crucifix inside. You're the hunter, the wife. Can you rest in paradise? Every little word that he loved, every little Mona Lisa, every little work, a picture for your time. Every little starry night, every little color bright, every little
little time you cry with glitter in your eye for the crime. Oh. You're the color they don't like. Cause when you paint the sky. But you are beauty.
And that's our presentation. And you know, there is more where that came from. So I want to wish everyone happy Pride, a wonderful week ahead. And I look forward to seeing you again next year, maybe. Have a wonderful night. Thanks again to everyone who contributed.